Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Salisbury State University and its first Pauline Ryle Lecture Series, first of the Pauline Ryle Lecture Series. It's really wonderful to see so many people out there, 8 o'clock of a Thursday evening. It is Thursday, I hope. And to be able to give a special welcome to the members of the Delta Kappa Gamma Society, a society that Pauline Ryle was very, very active in, and a society that is very much in the forefront in advancing higher education and higher education. Pauline Ryle, I think, would be very, very pleased tonight to see out there teachers in the system, students, to see old friends, but she would be particularly pleased to know that we are honoring her wish in this lecture series that she has so richly endowed by bringing on this campus one of the finest, most talented individuals in the field of higher education, Dr. Ernest Boyer, whom you will hear more about momentarily. My job to welcome you, and I do. As I say, I wish Pauline could be here to see this, and is probably looking down on us right now. I had the privilege of knowing her for 4 or 5 years, and I feel very good tonight standing here, being able to kick off this inaugural lecture. Welcome to Salisbury.
Not too long ago, a very well-known educator wrote these words: "In measuring the quality of the college, one should ask, are there well-supported campus-wide activities, lectures, symposia, debates, concerts, and the like, that encourage community, sustain college traditions, and stimulate both social and intellectual interaction? And are these events well attended by both faculty and students?" There's at least one person in this room tonight who knows who wrote those words, because he's sitting to my right in the book Higher Education by Dr. Boyer. I think the answer to those questions regarding do we have these events and are they well attended by students and faculty is clearly an affirmative one. And although we're not a college any longer, I think we still measure up quite well in that regard. As Dean of the School of Education and Professional Studies, I'm delighted and I'm proud to see so many students and faculty and educators and concerned citizens in attendance tonight. It's my pleasure now to introduce the gentleman who will introduce the guest speaker. And I'd be remiss if I didn't say a few words about the contributions of Dr. Morris Bosman in putting this program together and in being the steward of the Ryle gift. Dr. Bosman is on sabbatical leave this semester. And I think just from hearing the stories of the aggravation in getting things set for tonight and understanding that this afternoon the flowers weren't here because they were taken away prematurely, and some of the other details which just almost didn't come quite to pass, he's probably going to come back and ask if he can have another sabbatical in the spring because he's worked too hard this semester to deserve that. We'll take that up when the request comes. But in all seriousness, his contribution to the School of Education for many, many years has been a terrific one. And his willingness to take on the responsibility of the Ryle program has been absolutely outstanding. So Morris, thank you very much on behalf of the school and of the university. Thanks again.
I must say first, thank you all for coming. It's just most gratifying to have such a wonderful response. It's just a pleasure and a special honor to introduce the first distinguished speaker in the E. Pauline Ryle Lecture Series. Miss Ryle, whom I had known as my principal at the campus school, would be especially proud to have her name associated with such an outstanding national educator as our speaker, Dr. Boyer. Dr. Boyer is president of the Carnegie Foundation for the Advancement of Teaching, something that was very, very dear to her heart. And it was only fitting that we have such a presentation as the very first major address. Dr. Boyer, in addition to being president of the Carnegie Foundation, is a senior fellow of the Woodrow Wilson School at Princeton University and an education columnist in the London Times. There are so many accomplishments that and honors that Dr. Boyer has received, but I only attempt to highlight a few because I most anxiously await what he has to say. Dr. Boyer's achievements are extensive, having served as the 23rd United States Commissioner of Education, was Chancellor of the State University of New York for 7 years, which is one of the country's largest universities, was listed by the United States News and World Report as one of the top educators in the nation for 5 consecutive years. Chosen by his peers as the Man of the Year in Higher Education in 1987. Holds honorary degrees from 85 colleges and universities. You can obviously know that he is doing something right. He was named by 3 presidents of the United States to national commissions. In addition, he's deeply committed to the arts, and he's authored the widely acclaimed book, High School, and his most recent work, College, the Undergraduate Experience. Currently, he's working on a book that he will be telling you, and I'm sure we'll be referring to, on early years of as the third in the sequel of research-based books that have been published. He's a man that is truly committed to excellence and is truly making a difference in education. It is my pleasure to present to you Dr. Ernest Boyer, and we're going to have a seat down in the audience so we can enjoy his presentation. Dr. Boyer.
Thank you very much, Mr. President, Dean, Morris. Those were enormously generous remarks, and I'm grateful. You did forget to mention that I was president of my 8th grade class. In fact, for 2 consecutive years, I was president. I am also pleased to inaugurate this lecture series honoring Professor E. Pauline Ryle. This native of the Eastern Shore gave over 40 years to the cause of education. Her life is an inspiration to us all, and I know of no greater tribute to the educator we honor this evening than to recall that she said of herself, "The real enjoyment of my life has centered on the children, not on the schools, not on the curriculum, not on teaching, not on testing, but on the children." I'm also pleased to be at Salisbury State University, which has for more than 60 years committed itself to excellence in education. I rejoice with you in the new university status, which recognizes both your quality as well as your expanded mission, and I congratulate the faculty that served with such distinction and to the president who for 8 years has provided brilliant leadership in guiding the destiny of this nationally regarded center of higher learning. Well, as everyone in the room must know, it's been 5.5 years since the National Commission on Excellence in Education said that if an unfriendly power had attempted to impose on the United States the mediocre educational performance that exists today, we might well have viewed it as an act of war. Since that hyperbole hit the headlines, this nation has been engaged in the most serious and the most sustained and bipartisan drive for school renewal in its history. Thanks to governors and educators and legislative leaders, Education has been at the top of the national agenda, and I applaud much of the progress that has been made. But with all of our achievements, I am convinced the time has come to move to a more substantial agenda. And tonight, in the few moments that I have with you, I should like to focus on four or five priorities that must be met if we hope to achieve excellence by the year 2000 and beyond. By the year 2000, America will be a nation in which one out of every three pupils in the public schools will be poorer and more ethnically and linguistically diverse. These are precisely the students for whom the public schools historically have been least successful. And frankly, I worry that with all of our talk about excellence in education, the schools that need the most help still get the least. Today, in most urban schools in the United States, at least 4 out of 10 students are absent on any given day, and many drop out before they're handed a diploma. Consider the following statistics. In Philadelphia, the dropout rate is 38%. In Boston, it's 43%. In Chicago, in 1984, over half the seniors failed to graduate, and among those who did, only 1/3 were reading at the 12th grade level. Last year in the Cleveland Public Schools, there was not one single semifinalist in the National Merit Scholarship Competition. There were 15,000 awarded nationwide. What we could be left with in the United States in our inner cities is a kind of educational third world. And I'm convinced that unless we deepen our commitment to educate our least advantaged students, this nation will be economically and socially imperiled. Now, I know there are no easy answers. If there were, we would have found them long ago. However, what is clear to me is that poverty and schooling are inextricably connected, and that what we see as poor performance in the classroom may, in fact, relate to events that precede schooling and even precede birth itself. Let me give you just one example. The growing fetus requires a diet that is rich in vitamins, minerals, and protein. And a recent report from the Harvard School of Public Health revealed that a child who was undernourished during pregnancy and soon after birth, such a child will have lower IQ, lower attention span, and lower grades in school. But what's discouraging is that in the United States today, 40% of all those officially classified as poor are children under 6. And frankly, I find it a national disgrace that in the richest nation in the world, 40% of the children are classified as poor and millions of little children are tragically undernourished. Now, I realize that to talk about babies and poor health may appear far off the school reform agenda, and yet, at least to me, the evidence is overwhelming. The educational problems cannot be divided from problems of the poor and from the health of little children. Winston Churchill had a way with words, and he said it elegantly by observing, "There is no finer investment for any community than putting milk into little babies." And I believe that better schooling means confronting poverty and providing better nutrition and better preschool education for our at-risk children. If we do not understand that social policies cannot be divided, we cannot have James Madison High School unless we understand that we have millions of poor children who are being given a bad start in their way towards school achievement. This leads me to priority number 2. I'm convinced that between now and the year 2000, the school schedule in the United States must begin to change to reflect the changing work and family patterns in the nation. My grandfather Boyer was born in 1872. He died 1 month short of his 100th year. And during the century of his life, the world became a wholly different place. We moved from grandpa's horse-drawn plow to John Glenn's liftoff into space. Incidentally, when grandpa was in his early 90s, I asked him one day what he thought about man walking on the moon. He looked at me with a twinkle in his eye and he said, "Ernest, the moon was made to look at, not to walk on." And I'm convinced that to his to his dying day, Grandpa was convinced that the idea of moonwalking was the fantasy of a not too well held together grandson. Well, Grandpa, the larger point was that Grandpa grew up on a Southwest Ohio farm. One day when he was 96, I said, Grandpa, tell me about the schooling that you'd had. I'd never really asked that question up till then. And he said, well, he said, I went to school, I guess, a total of about 3 years. I went long enough to read and write, which would have been cultural literacy in those days. He said, I walked 6 miles to school, and I went only in the winter when I wasn't needed on the farm. Incidentally, I've noticed that the distance one walks to school is usually directly proportionate to one's age. So Grandpa says he walked 6 miles, he walked 6 miles. At least it seemed like 6 miles. The point I make is that when today's calendar was set about a century ago, with 9 months of study, 3 months off, over 90% of all the school-aged children in the United States were like Grandpa Boyer, living on a farm with their mothers and their fathers, working hard, staying at home, tending all the crops. We developed a school calendar to match the work and the family patterns of the nation. When children were not in school, they were engaged productively with their families. And incidentally, on rainy days, large numbers of children showed up at school, and on sunny days, very few, because they probably were engaged with chores, and people understood the ground rules of those days. Well, I don't have to tell you that today the world has been turned upside down. Less than 3% of America's families now live on farms, and in most households, both parents work away from home. Nearly one-fifth of today's families are headed by a woman. Two-thirds of these women work. And about half the children now in first grade, those who enrolled in first grade this fall, will have lived in a one-parent family by the time they graduate from high school. I believe that as we approach the year 2000, the school arrangements increasingly will reflect the changing family patterns of the nation. Last year at the National Press Club, I proposed a new extended school program for the nation's schools. I proposed that we should have more pre-kindergarten programs. I proposed that we have more afternoon enrichment programs from 2 to 5 o'clock in the afternoon to handle the latchkey problem. We just surveyed some junior high school students at the Carnegie Foundation, and about 60% of them said they go home to an empty house with no adults. I also proposed a summer program for children who are now drifting in the streets. The affluent families send their children off to summer camps, computer camps, swimming camps, tennis camps, but the non-affluent have no place to send their children. I'm suggesting that such a schedule, that is pre-kindergarten, afternoon enrichment, summer session programs would recognize the reality of family life. But I also believe that schools cannot do the job alone, and frankly, I worry mightily about the increased dependency on the school to do what the families and the churches and the communities have not been able to accomplish. And there's urgent evidence that the schools are increasingly becoming surrogate families for the children, and that families and parents are increasingly detached. And I find that a pathology that not only will mean poor education, but a terrible sense of drift among the children. The extreme of that perhaps was seen about 6 months ago when I visited a school in Lower Manhattan. The children are brought there at 7:30 in the morning and they're bused home at 6:30 in the evening, and they've had all three meals with a two-platoon teacher system. These, of course, as I say, are extremes, but they're a signal of what seems to me a disintegration that inevitably will place impact on the schools. In fact, the more time I spent with the high school study, the more I became convinced that the family is a more imperiled institution than the school. And I also believe that not only do we need these new school arrangements, but inevitably, I think to allow parents to participate, we're going to have changes in the workplace so that occasionally parents could get time off with pay to come to school and participate with teachers in the counseling of their children. I mean, after all, we give people off a free time with pay to go to jury duty. We give them time off to vote. Is it unthinkable that in the future the workplace will have to accommodate some time as well so that parents can be increasingly integrated in the counseling and the education of their children? I am suggesting that inevitably the workplace and the home must somehow be increasingly connected with the school and that parents must be partner in the process. Well, this brings me to issue number three, and perhaps it's most centrally related to the person that we celebrate tonight. I believe that increasingly this nation must give more recognition and more status to the teacher. The truth is that while Americans have always had a love affair with education, we have at the same time been enormously ambivalent about our teachers. While preparing our Carnegie Foundation report on high school, I read a fascinating story about a 19th century Nebraska school that colorfully described, I think, our ambivalence about teachers. The writer, it was an autobiographical account, said that in the fall in the little one-room schoolhouse he attended, the first teacher who came was run out of town, he said, by boys who used stones as weapons of assault. He said the second teacher met the same agony, but when the third teacher, he said, had soundly thrashed one boy and had also thrashed the father of another, the reign of terror ended. Parents need chastising too. Today we don't stone our teachers and run them out of town, but we do expect them to do what our homes and our churches and our communities have not been able to accomplish. And when they fall short anywhere along the line, we condemn them for not meeting our idealized expectations. And yet it is my deep conviction that most school critics could not survive one week in the classrooms that they so urgently condemn. During our high school study, again, I was struck that the basic problem in most of our schools is not low salary, although it's still too low. Let the record show, however, that during the past 8 years, there has been a 59% increase in teacher salaries across from coast to coast, and now the average salary is $28,000. Still not high enough, but moving in the right direction. But the basic problem, I think, is not salaries. It's what we call in our report the working conditions. Often too many students, too much paperwork, too little time to prepare and to be renewed, and frankly, too many mindless interruptions. And I must say that the public address system has become a symbol of all that's gone wrong in public education. I was in a classroom several years ago where the idiot box belched out three times, and this teacher was expected to maintain equanimity and smile knowingly with that interruption and then come back with the lesson at hand. And the announcements included such earth-shaking problems as the lunch money of a single child was to be picked up at the central office. And there was going to be a pep rally Friday afternoon. And then we wonder why children don't have respect for the priorities of education. I'm generally pacifistic in my inclination, but I can only tell you if that teacher would have said, I'm going to march to the central office and find out who is in charge of this interruption, I'd have joined the march and would have been delighted to watch him twist slowly in the wind. I was talking about this several years ago to a group of teachers, this interruption without warning of the public address system, and afterward a teacher came to me and said, well, she said, that's not true. She said, at my school, they go before they make the announcement. So, somewhere it is. In any event, every cloud has a silver lining, I suppose, but there is a truth here that's absolutely fundamental. If we look below the paperwork and the public address system, we are often impressed that we are more concerned about procedures than we are about the excellence of education. We are more concerned about the process than the substance. And unless we give more authority and empowerment to the teachers and free them to do the job that is at hand, I think we will get precisely the education we deserve. And that means, frankly, occasionally recognition that can be as simple as a thank you very much. Sometimes we look for the heroic answers when, in fact, they're right at our very doorstep to be grasped. I was meeting a group of students when I was Commissioner of Education, and I asked them about the quality of their education in the public schools, and it was a conversation that was enormously reassuring. Near the end of the seminar, I said, I have just one or two other questions before we adjourn. I said, how many of you have ever had a teacher who's changed your life? And every hand went up. And then I said, how many of you have ever thanked a teacher? And not one hand was raised. And after an awkward moment, one of the students said, well, she said, it's just not the thing to do. Oh, there you have it, I said. You've now put the finger on the problem. How many of you, I said, could go into a classroom day after day, have a teacher inspire you, and actually change your life by your own confession, it's gone on, and then see these students stare at you as if you were Brontosaurus warmed over, and walk from the room without a signal of response? I said, that's asking too much. So perhaps a bit too cutely, I said, promise me one thing, before you graduate, take a teacher to lunch instead of have one for lunch. And they all agreed they would. Thank yous do not take a public referendum. They hardly take a moment. And yet the truth is that a teacher who gets a signal of support will live with that for days as a stimulation that says somehow lives are being changed. Teachers don't go into teaching to make millions, they go into teaching to change lives, but someone has to tell them that the process is succeeding. And that's a contribution everyone can make. And this nation has not, frankly, been given dignity to its teachers, and we're paying a price that's enormously consequential. We sometimes look to Japan as a model to be imported to the United States. No, not at all. We are already perhaps importing too much from overseas. It's not time to import the Japanese school system along with their Hondas and Toyotas. I do believe, however, there are two conditions in Japan worth noting, and having had grandchildren in the Japanese schools, I can attest to what I'm about to say. In Japan, there is an absolute connection between the parents and the school, so that the home is seen as an extension of the educational institution. And the second circumstance is that in Japan, the term sensei, teacher, is a title of great honor. It's culturally affirmed. It carries with it dignity and status, because to be a sensei is to be a carrier of tradition and to be a shaper of the coming generation. And I believe if you take sensei in Japan and just a teacher in the United States, you may come closer to what is in fact at the heart of our comparisons than any other single criterion I know. Several years ago, I couldn't sleep, and instead of counting sheep, I counted all the teachers I'd had. And there were a few nightmares in the bunch, but I remember rather vividly about 15 or more. And then I recalled the outstanding individuals who had truly changed my life. And as some of you have heard before, I thought first about Miss Rice, my first grade teacher. First day of school, on the way to school with my mother, I said, will I learn to read today? And my mother said, no, not today, but you will before the year is out. I really did think you went to school to learn to read. My mother and father used to send notes back and forth to one another. And as they say in Washington, my brothers and I weren't in the loop, so I wanted to break the adult code. Well, I walked into the room, and guess what? There Miss Rice stood, half human, half divine. And I really did believe that in the afternoon she ascended into heaven, and the next morning just came down to teach the class. She seemed half angelic. Incidentally, it was in Dayton, Ohio, and it was against the law to teach and also to be married. So she was called a maiden lady. It had something to do with not mixing business and pleasure, I understand. In any event, it was one of those bureaucratic mandates of the day. first thing I ever heard from Miss Rice, my teacher, was, "Good morning, class. Today we learn to read." First words I ever heard. Not one child said, "No, not today. Let's string beads." If she says we learn to read, we learn to read. And we spent all day on four words. I'll go to school. Traced them, sang them, and God forgive her, even prayed them. She had worked out a little prayer. Thank you, God, I go to school. Kind of meat and potatoes, but probably would have landed her in jail. On that delicate subject, I heard recently that the one prayer in school that's acceptable to all faiths is, "Dear God, don't let her call on me today." But speaking of Miss Rice, I ran home that night and was higher than a kite. I said, "Today I learned to read." Well, I hadn't learned to decode, I don't believe, but I'd learned something much more fundamental. I'd learned that language is the central priority of learning. And when I tried to write a book high school, I had a chapter right up front called Language, the Essential Skill. And then college, I had a chapter called Language, the Essential Skill. And if we ever do one on graduate education, there'll be that tired chapter, Language. But I want to make the point that it's the continuing influence of an unheralded first grade teacher, Fairview Avenue Elementary School, 1930 whatever, who lives on forever. And when I talk about the centrality of language, I'm talking Miss Rice, and on and on and on. And incidentally, for the record, let me say that I think the early years are the most essential in all of formal learning, and that if we would give as much status to first grade teachers as we give to full professors in this country, that one act alone, perhaps, could radically reform the nation's schools. I don't know how many of you have seen the little essay written by a friend of mine that's entitled, "All That I Ever Really Needed to Know I Learned in Kindergarten." And he goes on to say, "I learned don't hit people, put things back where you found them, cookies and milk are good for you, take a nap every afternoon, that's especially important for principals and academic deans." And then that wonderful little conclusion where he says, "And when you go out into the world, always remember to hold hands and stick together." Now, I don't want to be romantic, but I do believe that in the early years, there is an integrated view of learning, a sense of discovering the individual and linking the knowledge to the realities of life that tends to get lost in the fragmentation and our inclinations toward feigned erudition. So I would like to see us affirm the essentialness of the early years and give status to those first teachers who provide the foundation for all future learning. And to me, language is the central claim of all. I recall Mr. Whitlinger, who was a high school history teacher, who said to me quietly during class, "Ernest, I'd like to meet you after class." Well, I had cardiac arrest and sweaty palms. I mean, teachers don't just ask to see you to pass the time of day. But when I went to see him, something transforming did take place. He said, "Ernest, you're doing very well in history. You keep this up, you just might be a student." You may chuckle, but it was the highest academic accolade that I'd received. And last night on the way home, "You mean I'm not going to be a ball player or a cowboy or a fireman? I might be something called a student." He caused me to shake my brain and redefine who I was and what I might become. I suspect that everyone in the audience tonight can remember at least one great teacher you've had. And if this were a Quaker meeting and I were to open it to everyone assembled, I'd be interested to know who you would wish to celebrate this evening. And certainly we're assembled here because of Professor Pauline Ryle, the influence of which in the classroom and then in the teaching of other teachers. Can you imagine the multiple effect that will never end? As a student is taught, they become teachers, they teach others, and the multiple of that goes on forever. I'm suggesting that if we want excellence in education in this country, it means excellence in teaching, and that if the future of this nation is to be made secure, we should be less concerned about getting weapon systems into space and more concerned about getting outstanding teachers into the classrooms here on earth. Here I would like to digress for just a moment and say a word about the preparation of our teachers. I believe that all future teachers need to know about our Western heritage, about our civic institutions about mathematics, science, literature, geography, and the arts. What a mouthful. But that's what we ask our elementary teachers to convey. I believe they should be empowered in the use of language, as I've just suggested, or to put it simply, I believe students should become culturally literate, to use E.D. Hirsch's helpful formulation. But as we approach the year 2000, I also believe that all teachers must become familiar with cultures and languages other than their own. During our study of the American high school, we discovered that only two states require students to complete a course in non-Western studies. And 2 years ago, in a survey of 5,000 undergraduates, we learned that over 30% of today's college students said they had nothing in common with people in other developed countries. I am concerned that education in this country may become more parochial at the very moment the human agenda is more global, and I am concerned that our future teachers not only master the essential content of our culture, but understand how it fits in the story of an interdependent world, not only combined socially, but ecologically as well. When I was commissioner, again, Joan Cooney, the marvelous creator of Children's Television Workshop, came to see me one day, and she had, as you know, been the creator of Sesame Street, and she wanted to start a new program on science for junior high school students. And we helped fund the program, and it became known 3-2-1 Contact. You may have seen it. But in doing survey for that science junior high school program on television, they surveyed some students and asked some simple questions such as, where does water come from? And a sizable percentage said the faucet. And where does light come from? And they said the switch. And where does garbage go? They said down the chute. Well, these were students in New York City, and that was better than out the window. Incidentally, these questions were asked before that barge was floating in endlessly offshore. I rather regretted seeing them find a place to dump that garbage, because I was rather hoping that every night at 6 o'clock, Americans during dinner would have to look at the television as that barge without a country was floating, reminding us that in the future, one of our greatest problems may not just be producing and consuming, but discarding our own waste. That is, we are living in a world of inevitable cyclicness, and how can we somehow see the interdependent nature of our globe? I'm suggesting that we live in a village that is ecologically imperiled, and yet for far too many students, their knowledge of nature and its resources goes about as far as the refrigerator door, the VCR knob, and the light switch on the wall. I'm proposing that to be well prepared to teach in the 21st century means understanding our interdependent world, and it means having teachers who can link the curriculum of the classroom to the realities of life. It puts a huge obligation on the liberal arts college, on the undergraduate experience, on the general education core, and on the majors that we provide the future teachers of this country. Over 40 years ago, Mark Van Doren wrote that the connectedness of things is what the educator contemplates to the limit of his capacity. He concluded by saying that the student who can begin early in life to see things as connected has begun the life of learning. And I'm convinced that teacher preparation means not just having information, it means integration and application too. Well, this brings me to one final observation. Talked about the imperiled student and the linkages to poverty. I've talked about the urgent need to readjust the calendar. I've talked about the need to celebrate great teachers and to prepare them for the task. But would you believe it, here at the end, I'd like to say a word about the students. I find that almost surprising, because students are rarely mentioned in the talk about school reform. Indeed, let the record show that the most celebrated report, A Nation at Risk, mentions the word children only once. It talks about systems and competitiveness and hardly notices that there are students in the classroom. But during our study of the American high school, I concluded that we have not just a school problem, but a youth problem in this nation. and it seemed quite clear to me that one of our greatest problems in many schools is the anonymity among the students. The harsh truth is that teenagers in America today are expected to be out of sight and off the streets, and when we see them in groups of more than three or four, we wonder what they're up to. In fact, we want them to be kept in school and out of sight, and the only place out of school where it's safe to be a teenager are the shopping malls, where young people can drift around for days and hardly be noticed by adults, but not out on the street. Former U.S. Commissioner of Education Doc Howe put the issue squarely when he said that today teenagers are an island in society. Howe went on to say that the message young people receive from the adult world is, we have no use for you while you're young. You are socially and economically irrelevant to the larger world. And I worry especially about the fact that young people and older people are not seriously engaged. We have a generational separation in which we put little children in daycare centers, put middle-aged children in schools, and old people in retirement villages, and they increasingly do not talk to one another. My own parents have for years been in a retirement village near Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. My father recently deceased, but one of the virtues of that retirement village was that they had a daycare center there, so that in the morning about 50 or 60 little 4 and 5 year olds would come trucking up, and that may not be your view of retiring, but there it is. But my wife's mother is there as well. She's 88, and guess what? She gives breakfast to 50 little 4 and 5 year olds at 6:30 in the morning, and they're picked up at 5:30 in the afternoon. But the nice feature is that they are all adopted grandchildren and their adopted grandparents, so that my father had a little boy that was his adopted grandson who would come to visit him during the afternoon. So when I'd call my daddy, he'd tell me with enthusiasm about how I'd spent the day with this bright little fellow. When I'd visit him, he'd have all the wonderful pictures on the wall like grandparents are inclined to do. And daddy would refer to him as my little friend. Incidentally, and somehow there was a power when this little five-year-old saw the dignity and the agonies of aging, and there was something renewing about an 85-year-old person spending time with a child who was at the threshold of another life. Incidentally, I heard recently that the reason grandparents and grandchildren get along so well together is they have a common enemy. But the larger point I want to make today is that I am concerned that young people, feeling alienated, tend to create their own culture, live in their own world, even to create their own music. Just last week, I happened to read the lyrics of a hugely popular Bruce Springsteen record that spoke powerfully of the contemporary mood. I am not able to understand this language, so I had to read it. The lyrics, which some of you may know quite well, were revealing to me as I looked across the page. These words would hardly be awarded the Nobel Prize in Literature, but they read as follows, and I quote, "Baby, this town rips the bones from my back. It's a death trap. It's a suicide rap. We gotta get out while we're young, 'cause tramps like us, baby, were born to run." Death trap, a suicide rap? What's this all about? Is anybody listening? But what's especially disturbing is that some of this spirit of alienation is found within the school itself. Beginning especially in the junior high school years, many students move facelessly from class to class. These young people have little sustained interaction with adults. And teenagers in our schools lose their identity at the very time when a sense of belonging is needed most. And many of them drop out because no one noticed that they had, in fact, dropped in. Where in the reform movement is this issue discussed? Where, Mr. Bennett, does this issue fit into James Madison High School, you so elegantly described? I should add, we're looking at junior high school now, and we've just finished a survey of 7 to 11 year olds. 40% of them said they're frequently lonely, and over 60% of them, as I said, go home to an empty house, and over 60% said they wish they could spend more time with their parents. Frankly, if I had just one wish for school reform, and hold your hats, it wouldn't be another Carnegie unit, wouldn't be another national test. I would like to see every high school broken up into units of no more than 400 students each. I'd like to see every high school student have a mentor who genuinely knew who they were and how they felt. And above all, I'd like to see young people feel needed and have a sense of worth. And in the Carnegie Report High School, we propose a new Carnegie unit, a community service program to help students see a connection between what they learn and how they live. The goal we have in mind is to help young people become responsibly engaged in youth clubs, in retirement villages, and perhaps even tutoring other children at the school. The passivity in the classroom is appalling. Is it unthinkable to suggest that as students learn, they in turn could be encouraged to teach others and understand the sense of worthwhileness in their lives? Several years ago, I asked my wife, Kay, who her most impressive teacher was, and I was rather taken aback when she said, my older sister, Sarah. So happens Kay went to a one-room schoolhouse in eastern Pennsylvania, in Bucks County, Pennsylvania. As a little girl, her older sister was 2 years ahead of her, and when she went to first grade and began to cry and couldn't quite get the lessons and felt alone, the teacher quite wisely, and perhaps even out of desperation, would say, Sarah, why don't you go and help your little sister, Catherine? Well, I'm not advocating for one-room schoolhouses, you know that. I'm trying to raise another point, that while we're talking about more Carnegie units and more testing and more teacher preparation and national certification, is anyone asking about the students? And I believe that unless we start looking at the youth conditions in our culture and what's happening to our children, we may save the schools and lose the students. H.L. Lindsay wrote on one occasion that it's the world's one crime, its babes grow dull. Not that they sow, but that they seldom reap. Not that they serve, but have no God to serve. Not that they die, but that they die like sheep. The tragedy of life is not death. The tragedy is to die with commitments undefined, with convictions undeclared, and with service unfulfilled. Here then is my conclusion. As we move toward the year 2000, we should celebrate the gains that we have made. But I believe we have five other obligations to fulfill. We must confront the problems of poverty among our children. We must respond to the changing work and family patterns of the nation. We must give more recognition and more status to our teachers. We must prepare teachers who can go beyond the isolated facts and see connections that are global. And above all, we must begin to help students understand that to be truly human, one must serve. John Gardner said on one occasion that a nation is never finished. You can't build it and leave it standing as the pharaohs did the pyramids. It has to be recreated for each new generation. I'm convinced that the most urgent task our generation now confronts is the rebuilding and the reaffirming of the nation's public schools. And as we so do, we pay tribute to the life and legend of Professor Pauline Ryle. Thank you very much.
Thank you for a marvelous address. Dr. Boyer has agreed to field questions from the audience, and we hope that you'll feel free to ask those.
Okay, is there anyone who wants to say something or make a speech or move to adjourn or pick up a point that I mentioned that you would like to pursue further or perhaps challenge directly? Yes, please.
Are there models currently that follow what you suggest that have been tested in terms of the number of 400 maximum?
There, thank you. The question was, are there models dealing with greater student intimacy that overcomes the one pathology of anonymity? I should have said there are three words that I think mark the climate of the schools that worry me. Anonymity is one, irrelevance of the curriculum is another, and uselessness is the third. Buried in those three attitudinal conditions, I think, are the elements of school failure and school dropout. All of you would know experiments that have tried to get to the business of greater human encounter, more of a human scale school. The traditional school within school movement, some districts, for example, my grandson is just starting high school in Brookline, Massachusetts. You may have heard of it. Brookline has still what they call school within schools, and my grandson was saying that he is with a group of 300 in a large school that has, I think, several thousand. Now, I can't tell you how valuable that social unit is. That's still a big unit to identify with, but it has a name, and I think he feels some identity. I'll ask him in a few months what that part of the school within a school is. There have been, of course, many of the so-called magnet schools. If you look at the magnet school movement, I think they're trying to touch two issues. One is anonymity, that is overcoming scale. The other is relevance, that is creating a defined curriculum that's appealing to the student. I think it has huge failure, or huge, I think the magnet school movement has some dangers because it tends to be an arrangement where the few can opt out. It hasn't been universally institutionalized, and that worries me when it's simply a compelling option for maybe those who are already highly motivated. So I worry, but the principle is there nonetheless. These are all experiments on the edges. Ted Sizer's Essential Schools Network, I think if you listen to Ted Sizer talk, you hear him powerfully discuss not standards or curriculum and testing, although those are not unimportant. I don't want to push it off. I'm saying, though, that he talks very heavily about creating schools that are, in a sense, humane, more intimate institutions with a whole variety of experiments behind it. Strange you should ask. I almost missed my plane this morning because I spent the morning with a delegation from Great Britain. They came presumably to learn from me. They're having more violence in the schools in England than it's quite un-British to have people attack teachers. And I assured them it's un-American too, but they didn't quite believe me. But as it turns out, I learned some things. One of the delegates was head of a large, what we would call, public high school. Large by their definition, 1,800. He said every freshman class comes in as a separate unit. It meets together. Every grade level is organized as a single unit within the school. More than that, he said every student is assigned to a group of 25. And they have a mentor, and that group meets every morning for a half hour. Through the whole school, groups of 25 meet with the same teacher mentor to talk about the day, to talk about what they did last night. They might review their homework. This is not an academic course. This is a social community unit. And that's the way they begin their day. He said no student in that school would ever imagine they were a part of an 1800 unit. They're a part of a 25 unit. Now, they also go to classes, but that teacher has the health records of everyone in the 25. That teacher has interviewed every parent, he said, sometimes several times a year. He knows the health record, the former academic record, and when the teacher, the mentor, meets with that 25, they have had a cumulative record so that they begin knowing each student intimately. Now, it's what you might call, I guess, a mentor counseling model, but instead of having one for 350, as we do, which may be available if you're in crisis, it's institutionalized. So what he described to me, if I heard correctly, and I'm going to send one of our colleagues over to, not because I didn't believe him, but I wanted to see how it worked actually, what he's done is take the academic departmental structure, which tends to take 1,800 and organize them by classes and tend to get lost, and he's overlaid that with a social community mentoring unit so that you're a member, in the one instance of 25, while at the same time you're moving through an academic structure on a much larger scale. But the point being, 25 every morning, the day begins. It's little, sort of like the homeroom notion, you know, in our terminology. Now, that's what I'm looking for in trying to model. I think you can also take old buildings and break them up into smaller units. In fact, I proposed, and I saw that Time magazine 2 weeks ago in its essay on education for the next president picked up this suggestion. The first time I've seen it made me feel good. Don't expect it to happen, but I proposed that the federal government launch a low-interest loan school facilities improvement program in which districts could apply for a low-interest loan from the federal government to refurbish old buildings, and not only to stop the leaky roofs and the plumbing that leaks and to get some facilities in the labs, but also to redesign the structures, to have the physical arrangements change so that you could have, in effect, schools within schools, or to break up these old buildings. I'd like to see some of the old buildings boarded up or burned down. In some of these cities, the average high school is 50 years old. They're absolute trash heap places. I'd like to see us find small units all around the town, cities, a floor level of a new office building, or perhaps an old brownstone. Why do we have to warehouse thousands of teenagers in one building, like a minimum security prison? In Atlanta, Georgia, there's a high school on the second level of Rich's department store, which is in the center of Atlanta. Students go to that school by going to Rich's department store, taking the escalator up, and getting off at the second level and go to their class. They mingle with adults. In fact, they point out not only do they come and stay, but they start dressing differently. No, I mean, they're with adults, and they see other teenagers going to work at Rich's. They're not herded off in a isolated unit. They mingle with the rest of the world. And that school, my point is, there is a school in the department store. And also, some of them have employment opportunities. But it's not a magnet school in the sense that it's linked. It's spatially provided in the heart of the city. I'm only kind of leaping around. You could all find, and incidentally, what I'm saying is, the literature's full of it. Nothing I said tonight is new or novel. I just think the priorities in the current reform movement have not focused on students and on what I think are some of the pathologies that are occurring outside the school that wave into the school itself. And I think the school may be the most stable and in some ways most supportive institution for young people in our society who are living with the other institutions crumbling and less supportive of them. And it sounds a bit awesome, but I think the school does, if properly arranged, have a chance to make connections and help to reaffirm community. Do you have any knowledge? I mean, I'm sure there are others here who maybe could add to these examples. I'd be pleased if you would. Or maybe some of the teachers who've been working this way yourselves. Yes, please. Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry, I missed the cultural. You mean diversity, cultural diversity?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me just pause by saying that I think the challenge of America, and therefore the challenge of our schools, is whether we can celebrate our commonalities amidst diversity. And I think there are ominous signals that we are fulfilling the Kerner Commission report of a divided nation. And with 30% or more of our children coming into the schools living in a all too isolated world, Hispanics are culturally isolated in many parts of the country. The big debate about bilingual education is not a pedagogical debate, it's a political debate. And the sides have divided themselves around isolation or forced integration. I mean, it's just below the surface a dangerously framed debate, and that's why the English First movement is dangerous to me. Not that I'm against English. I think all children should speak it and use it fluently. I'm against the politicization of language for the wrong reason. All I'm saying is there are signals that we're not handling very well the notion of our commonalities while we celebrate diversity. Now, your question is right on target. Part of it has to happen vicariously. That is, we need, through the literature and our textbooks, through the history that's well-balanced, dealing with the history of slavery, the history of Hispanic migration, reading some of the original literature and not just textbooks here, but homogenize some of this so that we understand. And on that regard, I'm frankly, as you can already suspect, more of an expansionist than a narrow definer. But I don't think these need to be trade-offs. I mean, our culture has always been fluid and expanding, and I'm worried about those who want to freeze frame it. But I think part of it is that our textbooks and our literature need to somehow be rich and diverse. I spoke on Monday evening at a national meeting in Washington called by the Martin Luther King Holiday Commission, chaired by Mrs. King. And that agenda was to fulfill another mandate, that is, the history and message of Dr. King become increasingly a part of the educational program and not simply a day of going to the beach and forgetting. So I guess I'd start with the curriculum, and I think, therefore, our teacher preparation program those programs, there's no one, there are many, they need to be enormously mindful of reminding our future teachers of the richness of the diversity in the classrooms they'll be going into. Third, we need aggressively to recruit more minority teachers into the classrooms so they can be models for increased black and Hispanic students, but that recruitment has to begin in junior high. I'd like to see every college in the country establish a network of school relationships in its region and start recruiting teachers at junior high school, give them summer fellowships to come to the campus and work with great teachers, say to them, you're good enough to be a teacher. And I think if we'd start tapping our gifted young people, and especially minority, in junior high and give them the incentives, just as we try to recruit engineers and others, we'd see a larger pool. But what's discouraging is it's a diminishing pool of teachers from minorities at the very time the numbers of children in the classrooms, minorities, will increase. Fourth example, I'm a great believer in extending the campus. I mean, this is a beautiful campus. I would love to, I've already applied for a job. I mean, it's just, you have a good feeling walking around. I'd love to spend my, you know, my dotage here and everything else. But I mean to say there is an inclination, though, for us to even have college campuses of islands of monastic isolation, not staging grounds for action. And I do worry that college campuses become insular. And I would like to see built into college experience, especially for future teachers, internships, field trips, so that you see this as an occasion where you can move out and learn and really see, in a sense, the region as the campus and not simply this particular geographic site. You see, so how students could frankly spend several weeks in Manhattan. I think that, I'll tell you, I left that school I referred to in my formal remarks deeply shaken as I saw tragic lives among little children who were being born under conditions that were almost impossible to imagine. I think you shouldn't get a teaching credential without having spent some days encountering the cutting edge of poverty through the prism of some of these schools. I really think we need to stretch ourselves here. And then finally, you refer to these, that was nice of you to read that one quote about what I think a college community is, but I think we need forums such as this, and where we come together and listen to guests and visitors. I'm enormously pleased to be here, and so what I'm about to say, I don't mean to diminish, but I think if I might be so bold, you might want to consider in one of your distinguished lectures bringing a black teacher from a poverty school to talk about what life is like each day. I've gone to education meetings for 230 years. I have yet to hear a school teacher keynote the event. I have heard all the experts from Mount Olympus say what should be done. Most of them haven't been in a classroom for 30 years. All I'm saying is, where are the voices of the people who really know? And so I would think periodically bringing to the campus some teachers who are working heroically under these conditions help to educate too, or lecture in the classes. Now again, I'm in no way criticizing, but I'm trying to answer, how can we, in other words, keep the flow of information? What I'm saying is keep ourselves well informed about the reality and not live in dream worlds. And more than that, my rule of thumb is, the more we know people, the less difficult it is to hate, and the more our urgencies toward compassion and understanding, I think, are increased. Now, sometimes you're disappointed, you know, but I believe overall people are good rather than bad. Teachers would rather win than lose, and so I operate on the assumption of the goodness rather than the badness. And I think, therefore, the more we reach out and touch, we'll understand, and therefore, I think the future will be increased. Maybe one or two questions, and then you've been patient. Yes, ma'am. The matter had to, we're now suddenly in Washington, and the Secretary of Education, so hold your hat. Compare it to my job. Well, I'll start with that. That's the easiest, perhaps, or at least the least dangerous. I was the last commissioner, and that meant that I worked bureaucratically in what was called health, education, welfare, and that meant that I reported to Joe Califano, not to the President of the United States. I met with him occasionally, but only in the presence and to back up Mr. Califano. On the other hand, I was by law fully responsible for 140 different programs that had been authorized by Congress, which at that time was $13 billion worth of federal money. I was legally responsible, just as the Secretary is, and swore to uphold the office. I thought I had more than enough to do and had no inclination to argue for a separate department. In fact, as Change Magazine will report, they asked me to reflect on this, and I did, and the article comes out, I guess, next month. I said that I agreed with Hale Champion, the undersecretary, who said that the argument for a new department, it wasn't as bad as the enemy said, nor as good as the advocate said. I always thought it as rearranging the flowchart, because the power comes from congressional authorizations, and I had them just as Mr. Bennett or Mr. Bell. I did say then, and oh boy, have I been proved true, the only difference will probably be more visibility. Because when Meet the Press wants somebody to speak, they'd rather have a secretary in charge of large programs than a commissioner who reports to. I mean, it follows. So when Mr. Califano would be on Meet the Press, he was in charge of health, education, and welfare. Well, now what did they ask about? Well, they asked about smoking and things like that, all of which, I mean, his portfolio was as big as the whole outdoors, and near the end they might say, oh, by the way, what about defaulting loans? And that was the big education question, see? My point being, he didn't have 30 minutes of questions on education, good or bad, he might have had one. On the other hand, when you're Secretary of Education, presumably they're gonna ask you, you know, about education. So my thought was, well, it won't give you more authority, it won't necessarily mean more control over schools, as some people argue, not at all. But it probably will give you more visibility because you are, and perhaps more influence in that you're sitting at the cabinet at the highest circle of government in America. Now, sentimentally, I argued it for the reason that if you believe that labor is important in America, and you believe that commerce is, and you believe that agriculture is, you might just argue that education is critical to our democracy, And bear in mind, we don't choose a cabinet by virtue of whether it's run from Washington. That's silly. Agriculture isn't run from Washington, or commerce, or labor. The only two cabinet officers that I know are run from Washington are defense and state. The rest simply reflect a priority. So you could make a case. All I'm doing is ruminating. So it's different in this way, that the new secretary has huge access to the media, and the visibility, the bully pulpit potential has enormously increased. Program has increased because Congress willed it. If Mr. Bennett would have had his way, it would probably have been reduced a third. So it wasn't advancing education at the federal level. That was advanced in spite of Mr. Bennett, not because of him. So the difference is primarily not authority, but visibility. And I guess on balance that's good. On the other hand, NEA in its wildest dream couldn't have imagined you'd have a secretary who would use it to bash education. I mean, what a strange development. I mean, is it really? I think, you know, the advocates are still kind of twisting and wondering what this is all about. Now, comments on the two, and I'll try to be very brief and also cautious. Well, I think Ted Bell is an enormously honorable man who deep down in his heart believed in education and felt again that most educators were trying to do a decent piece of work and believed that the federal government was a partner. He tried to be a good soldier and go up to the hill and argue for cuts, but he didn't believe it. Quietly said he didn't believe it. And he's been quite forthcoming about it, and I think his record is well remembered, and the history will show that he played that difficult role in an honorable fashion. He was caught absolutely in the crossfire of the ideology of that administration, which he didn't feel comfortable with, and he wrote about it in his book, and which he described to me privately in exquisite detail. But he survived with dignity, and more than that, bringing dignity to the office, I think he'll be well remembered, and it was, of course, on his watch when we had a Nation at Risk report, which was almost accidental, which the President of the United States first tried to bury. So it was a kind of a surprise to everyone that it became the national flashpoint for a crusade that will be remembered in at least a footnote to American history. So I like him very much, I respect his integrity, and I believe he sees the federal role with a reasonable balance, and he believes in educators and their work. Mr. Bennett is much more complicated, and I think his tenure is much more mixed. But out of fairness, I think he's a very intelligent man. I think he has defined with brilliance in his language, which I regard well, some of our problems in both schools and colleges. I think it has been enormously disappointing that he has increasingly suggested in much of what he said that the, quotes, establishment represent the problem, not the solution. And I think that's been a cheap shot that has caused a lot of people to feel pain and anger, and therefore created defensiveness among school teachers and college administrators and faculty to some extent, when in fact we all want basically the same thing. You can talk about problems, but you don't have to somehow suggest mischievous intentions. But it was couched in a way that people outside saw, ah, yeah, stick it to them. I mean, in his latest report, even, on the 5 years of the Nation at Risk, if you read the prologue correctly to that, it ends up by saying we've made some gains, we haven't made enough, and the reason we haven't is there are those teachers and their unions, and they're out there somehow dragging their feet. Now, I don't want to defend every teacher or certainly be an advocate for the unions. But again, to create this sense among teachers that somehow they represent the problem and that college administrators are more interested in budgets than they are in students and that students are more interested in stereos than they are paying off loans, and I quote almost precisely, threw into the debate, you see, kind of ad hominem attacks that I think, by my standard, diminish the force of the larger argument, which I don't deny. Or to say it another way, and this is where I close, I think this country has, for the last few years, been enormously ready to move education forward. We're as united on this as anything I know. Education is our civil religion. We want better schools for our children. And I don't think you, and I think that movement has been somewhat diminished by some divisiveness in the strategy of Mr. Bennett, although I think many people will feel that he lifted the awareness of education to a new level. He brought some intellectual vigor on some points and prepared some well-reasoned position papers on curriculum and schools that are of considerable merit and should be studied on their own. So I hope that's even-handed. I don't think there's any gain to, you know, to get in tis-taint arrangement. I've tried to be as careful in telling you my inner thoughts. Overall, though, closing comment, I think the last 8 years have been far more positive than negative for the nation's schools. I think we have seen the public committed to schools as never before. We've seen corporate leaders stick with it through thick and thin with fairly good attitude. I think even though they started out negative toward education, I think this administration has come around to, partly through Mr. Bell, to see it as an important and essential asset both politically and, I think, civically and economically. So this has been, I think, a very exciting moment. What I've tried to do tonight is to say two cheers. While we've had the regulatory aspects and while we've raised the awareness, I've tried to suggest there is a deeper, more fundamental level that perhaps touches the conditions of our children. And we can't look at schools in isolation. We must look at our culture, because you can't have an island of excellence in a sea of indifference. And we had better look at what's happening to our families and children and bring them somehow increasingly as partners in the schools and not expect the schools to do what the other social units in our society have not been able to accomplish. Some years ago, I spoke too long, and at the end, a member of the audience gave me a poem I shall never forget. It read as follows. It said, "I love a finished speaker. I mean, I really do. I don't mean one who's polished. I just mean one who's through." Thank you very much.
Thank you again, Dr. Boyer. It is obvious that you have made this, our first lecture, a huge success, and we're very grateful. All right. You are cordially invited to attend a reception in our social room. It's just out of the hall and to your left, and we hope the Wildfowl Museum is open for any of you who would like to go through as well. Again, thank you very much.
Real fine job.
Well, it was great to be here.